Great is our God. Welcome to the Riverside Church. This is Reverend Dr. Gomes. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. It was David who said long ago in the book of Psalms 103, "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and don't forget all his benefits, for it is he who heals all our diseases. Bless the Lord, O my soul." Today's lesson is another series, beginning in the book of Acts. I am going to speak on the topic, the ascension of Jesus Christ. The ascension of Jesus Christ. And we'll be looking at the book of Acts, chapter 1, a number of verses, and also in the epistles, the book of Ephesians in chapter 2. There are passages there that also remind us about this great ascension. For now, let us listen in to the Word of God and hear Luke as he records in the book of Acts this great phenomenal event. "The former treaties I've made, O Theophilus, of all that Jesus began to do and teach, until the day in which he was taken up. And after that, he, through the Holy Spirit, had given commandments unto the apostles whom he had chosen, and to whom also he showed himself alive. He showed himself alive after his passion by many infallible proofs, being seen of them 40 days, and speaking of things pertaining to the kingdom of God." Verse 9. "And when Jesus had spoke these things, while they beheld, he ascended, he was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight." And since today is about the seventh Sunday following Easter, I want to speak on this subject. Between Easter and Pentecost is the ascension. And next, our next lesson, number 2 in this Acts series, will deal with Pentecost. There's something awesome about what Luke said, how Jesus he showed up here and he showed up there on the road to Emmaus in the upper room a number of times to the women, Mary Magdalene, and to all of the apostles in the upper room. After Easter Sunday, he showed up and he was around and he was teaching for 40 different days, almost like a 40-day seminar that he gave them. And then this awesome, this phenomenal, after his work is done, he's ascended right in front of them up into glory. This is how Luke records this. While he was speaking to them, they beheld he was taken up in the clouds. There's something about God taking some up, isn't there? And this is nothing new to God's mighty work. You may remember in your Old Testament how Ezekiel was sort of taken up, sort of transported from here to there. You probably remember Elijah the prophet taken up in a chariot, and there was wheels within the middle of the wheels. You probably remember Paul saying something like, "I've been taken up to the seventh heaven." John, his visions are almost as though he's being transported visually and spiritually, and how he can see things in the future. But this is no new work for God Almighty to have his son go back up into heaven, is it? "After he said this, he was taken up before their eyes, and a cloud hid him from their sight." Acts chapter 1 and verse 9. "And while they were looking into the sky as he was going up, there were two angels. And they were saying, 'This same Jesus that is now going up into heaven, this same Jesus is coming back again in the same way.'" It's just that we don't know the day, the time, or the hour. Because we know what is coming as we read Holy Scripture, The original apostles, the disciples of Jesus didn't exactly know what was coming next. They spent 40 days with Jesus in this awesome seminar. They saw him ascend into heaven, and now they were told in verse 8 in 9 that it's not for you to know the times or the seasons, but you shall receive power, you'll receive the Holy Spirit, and you'll be witnesses in my name in Jerusalem, Judea, in Samaria, and the uttermost parts of the earth. They have that as a command. But they're told to go to Jerusalem, and that's where I stopped the reading this morning. They went to the upper room, and Luke mentions all the names that are there. And what is it that they did? First of all, let me let you know who was in the room. In verse 13 of Acts chapter 1, when they came in the upper room, there was both Peter and James and John and Andrew and Philip and Thomas and Bartholomew and Matthew, and also James the son of Alphaeus, Simon the Zealot, Judas, the brother of James. They all continued in one accord in prayer, and also with the women. So there were, the room gets filled with more and more, and one of the women, Luke mentions by name, it is Mary, the mother of Jesus. This is one of the last times we read about Mary in the New Testament. But she's in a place with all of the apostles, and they had a job to do. Matter of fact, Luke mentions that that in those days there was about 120 in the midst of the disciples. Whether they were all in the room or they're spreading out outside the room, it's amazing that they were just in probably a large area, big enough to contain them all in Jerusalem near the temple. What did they do? Number one, the first thing we notice that they did, because they knew that something was about to happen. The first thing they did was, in between Easter and Pentecost, the first thing they did, really, before they really made any judgments at all, because they knew a decision had to be made, and that decision was to select another apostle, and they had two to choose by, because Judas committed suicide, and they had 11, and they had to have this sacred number 12 be restored. And before they did that, the first thing they did was they went to God in prayer. They went to God in prayer. We know that the disciples spent time in prayer gathering in the temple. We know they spent time in prayer at various homes. Luke Acts chapter 1 verses 13 and following tell us, when they arrived, they went upstairs to the room where they were staying. And verse 14, they all joined together constantly in prayer, along with the women, Mary, the mother of Jesus, and the other 120. The apostles and 120 used this time to think and to pray how to resolve this unfinished business of selecting another apostle. Jesus had called 12 apostles. It echoed the 12 tribes of Israel. And now, with Judas' betrayal, the suicide, there were only 11. And they were not alone in doing this time of waiting. All they had to do was bring their question to God in prayer, and the Holy Spirit gave them answers. In between times, I think the first lesson we need, that we learn today, is the importance of prayer. Secondly, in between times, we also notice that there was action taken. They went beyond the prayer room, and they went on to action. And the Holy Spirit gave them the answer to their prayer, guided Peter, the Holy Spirit guided the church, and the Holy Spirit actually told them to appoint someone who would bring their numbers up to strength, literally and symbolically. And as the Holy Spirit guided them, there were two men, And they proposed Barsabbas, whose surname is Justice, and Matthias. Barsabbas and Matthias. Both met the Spirit's criteria. Both had been with Jesus since the baptism of John the Baptist right up through the Ascension. That's what the qualifications were. They wanted two men and they had to meet a certain criteria. So I'm noticing some spiritual lessons today concerning the ascension of Jesus Christ. Was first thing they did they went into a prayer mode, and secondly, they actually went into action. And thirdly, in between the times of Easter and Pentecost, there another thing I want us to notice, there were far more than just 12 disciples. There were far more than just the 12 disciples. I mentioned the women in the room. I mentioned the 120. I mentioned Barsabbas. I mentioned Matthias, you see. Yes, the 12 were handpicked, chosen by Jesus. They were called apostles. The word apostles is certainly different than disciple. A disciple is a follower of Christ. But I'm saying that there were far more than 12. That's just the point. That Jesus needed more than the 12. The church needed more than the 12. Eventually they would die of martyr death. We don't come second when it comes to God. He needs each and every one of us, is the point I'm getting at. I mentioned that there were more than 12. Another thing in leadership roles in the early church, that we read about in the Bible, we also know that there were far more than just men. That's another point. That's my point number four. There were far more than just men in the room. What do I mean by this leadership of women in the early church? What are their names? Well, we do see Mary, who's always of great, phenomenal respect. But if we go back just a little bit before Easter Sunday, when Jesus is in his days of teaching and preaching and the miracle work of Jesus, and when he was traveling from town to town, he always had an entourage with him. Of course, the 12. But notice what Luke says in my fourth point, there were more than just men in the room who had leadership roles. Looking back at the Gospel of Luke, chapter 8, and verses 1 through 3. Notice the names in this list. Luke says, after this, Jesus, we're going back now, before Easter, when Jesus was in his early days of bringing the good news, Jesus traveled about from one town and village to another. Traveling from here to there. He was proclaiming the good news of the kingdom of God. And also some women. Oh, and it says here that the 12 were with him, number one. The 12 were with him and also some women. That's my fourth point. They're named in verse 2, Mary called Magdalene, whom seven demons had come out. Here's someone following, traveling alongside Jesus and the 12. And also Joanna, the wife of Chusa. And Luke lets us know that Chusa was a manager of Herod's household. And Susanna. Here's three different women. And Luke also lets us know that there were many other women. And these women, what were they doing? They were helping to support Jesus and the 12 out of their own means, from their own earnings, from their own businesses, from their own ways of supporting him. Jesus' tour with the 12 and his tour with these ministering women, they provide us and let us know that there were just more than men in the room. And I'm reminded in my ministry how important the women are in our beginnings and sustaining what we do at the Riverside. prayer, action, far more than 12, Barsabas and Matthias, and far more than just men, Mary Magdalene, Susanna, and what was the other sister's name? Joanna. Her husband had a good job with Herod. I don't know if he wanted her to know, he wanted Herod to know that my wife is working for Jesus, but he probably brought in a good paycheck and she probably helped Jesus in a phenomenal way. Who was it that they chose between going back to the upper room and the Holy Spirit brings two people together, Barsabas and Matthias? Who was it? Those of you who are familiar and know your Bible, you know it was Matthias. Matthias who was chosen. They both had the same credentials. They both knew Jesus. They both followed Jesus. They were disciples of Jesus. They knew him for a long time, for those 3 years, from the baptism of John, when John baptized Jesus, all the way to the Ascension. That meant they were there all the time. Matthias was the one chosen. What does that remind us of? Have you ever been on a shot list? You know, you sent your resume in. You met all the criteria. You showed your best. You always try to do the best, but you end up on this shot list with impeccable credentials, but you're not chosen. That's probably how Barsabas felt that day, because it was Matthias. Luke tells us this. Now, I think Matthias, who was chosen, was the Holy Spirit's pick, God's choice. But also, Barsabas, his middle name, Justice, certainly came to him. Because later on, we learned that when the persecution came, it was not the apostles, but was the rest of the believers. Everyone spread are all outside of Jerusalem, a diaspora, when the persecution finally came upon this holy church, this New Testament church, this new movement, this good news church. They had to spread out all over Jerusalem or be put in jail. Later you read about the Apostle Paul, before he's an apostle, he's the guy putting everyone in jail. But it was the apostles that stayed in Jerusalem. Here's my point. All the believers, no doubt people like Barsabas might have been one of those scattered across Judea and Samaria and preaching the gospel, the good news, while all the others were staying in Jerusalem. If you're on a short list, pray in the upper room of your soul and realize that God has good news for you. I think one of the last points that I want to mention here is this. I think the most important, that there is heavenly news in the theology of the Ascension. What is that theology that we call, what is the teaching of the Ascension? What does it mean for you and I today? There's good news between Easter and Pentecost. There's one reverend who named Rosalind Brown. She postulates this, that we in the Western Church, she says both Catholic and Protestant, have a very weak understanding of the Ascension. Often we just see it as Jesus' departure from earth to glory. She maintains that we miss the essential truth of Ascension Day. And she goes on to postulate that Jesus entered as someone who was and is both fully divine and fully human. Jesus entered into heaven fully divine and fully human. I think most of us understand the divine part, but what are you saying about the human part? See, in the incarnation, in the birth of Jesus, he was born in the flesh. Here's the human part. God in Jesus Christ took our human nature and was born on earth. That's the incarnation. But the ascension, Jesus Christ took he took that humanity and divinity back to heaven. All skied, fully formed, nails in the hands, nail prints, scars on the forehead, scar on the side, holes in his feet. Jesus Christ's divinity and his humanity are in heaven. In other words, the ascension, rather than the crucifixion and the resurrection, as important as these events are, Jesus' divinity and his humanity are both in heaven. This is the point of Ascension Day. Listen carefully, the ascension of Jesus Christ's humanity is in heaven. Wounded humanity, bruised, scarred, because Jesus bore the scars of his crucifixion into glory. When we sing that song, "When I survey the wondrous cross on which the Prince of Glory died, my richest gain I count but loss, and poor contempt I put on all my pride, and see from his head and from his hands and his feet sorrow and love flow mingled down. Did ever such love and sorrow meet, or compose so rich a crown?" What am I saying about the ascension? We know because Jesus was taken up into heaven in bodily form, scars and all, so won't you and I. So won't you and I. That's the bottom line of Ascension Day Sunday. That one day, you too, and myself, those of us who've lived our lives and tried the best we could in our spiritual walk and journey with Jesus, after the grave, we too will be taken up, all fixed up, brand new, facing glory. The ascension is our central hope in Christ. We say that he died for our sins and was raised for our salvation. Matter of fact, this is what Paul says in Ephesians chapter 5, that God has made us alive with Christ even when we were dead in our sins. It is by grace that we're saved. God raised us up with Christ and he seats us with him in heavenly realms. In conclusion, there is good news in the ascension, isn't there? In between Easter and Pentecost is a time of prayer. It's number one. Number two, there's a time of action. And number three, we learn that there were more than just the 12. Barsabas and Matthias taught us that. We also learned that there were more than just the men. And there is good news, heavenly news for all of us. We know because Jesus was taken up into heaven in bodily form, scars and all. So won't you and I. Have you received Christ? Won't you come to him? Let him come into your heart and receive him today. This is Reverend Dr. Gomes at the Riverside. May the good Lord watch over you. May he bless you. May he keep you. May he smile his face upon you. May he grant you that holy peace. The Lord.